Rico, look, again, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for having me 10,000 kilometers apart from you. So we are all, at least I'm very socially distanced from you, which is a pity because I like to come in Brazil, as you know. To be honest, being in Ireland and we have typical Irish weather today, rain, and not warm rain, cold rain, very cold rain, actually. So it's a pity that I'm not with you physically, but Brazil is definitely always in my mind. And for those of you who can look over my shoulder, you see the Be Best, one of the Be Best cups in my Irish cupboard. So, there's always a bit of Brazil with me. I think I share my screen. Of course, the host disabled participants screen sharing. So somebody must help me with that, I think. But in the meantime, I
If you see a
can.
button, share screen.
Pressed on share screen. And
Share
then
screen,
said
just press.
host disabled participant screen sharing. So I can't show what I had in mind for you. But in the meantime, if we solve this, you asked me to say a little bit about my history. If you are ready, then I'll share my screen. No, I'm still disabled.
Oh. Pedi a todo mundo, por favor, para desligar os microfones enquanto não estiver falando. Did you find a look?
Yeah, I tried now 5 times.
Really?
Host disabled participant screen sharing. So that.
Yes, share screen in the bottom of your not working.
No, I get a message that says the host prevented screen sharing.
Oh, please, Thaís, provavelmente você tem que autorizar, por favor. Just a second.
No problem.
This kind of problem.
There we are.
It's
There.
frequent. It's the first time that happens, actually. I don't know what kind of command. Okay, you are starting.
Yeah, I only see a different screen than what I hoped for. That's interesting. Are we looking at the same?
Okay, great.
Yeah, it's that one that says bioprocess intensification. Do you have that one?
Yeah, we have that.
Okay, excellent. All right, very good. Well, apologies for whatever was my contribution to that. You asked me to say a few things about my history. I am for a long time at Delft University of Technology. I've done a PhD in Delft University. I've moved up the ranks to become a professor. I was doing all the right professor things, I think, graduating PhD students and master students and so on. I've always been very interested in how to translate my skills, our research results with industry to make that, things are really happening. And in the Netherlands, we are in a fortunate position to have quite a bit of the industry labs relatively close by. So I was very young and had that possibility already. Actually, my own PhD was in close association with the DSM company on an antibiotics project. Just to verify, Gonzalo, my screen is a bit messy, but you see only the slide, I hope. Or do you see my whole screen?
No, we see you and your slide. It's perfect.
Okay, muito bem. So there's one thing. Another thing is that the Netherlands is a small country. There is much more not Netherlands in the world than there is Netherlands. So I have been always very internationally oriented. I had appointments and collaborations all across the world. But there were firm ones. One was in Malaysia. I've spent about 6-7 years there. One was in the Philippines, also about 8 years. But while I was there, there was always a link to Brazil, particularly to Campinas and Unicamp. And my first stay in Campinas was in 1990. So that is 30 years ago. We could actually celebrate that I've been 13 years in touch with Brazilian colleagues. And fortunately, I saw some people at the screen that I know indeed for a very long time, sometimes even that 30 years. But international component was important to me. When I was moving on in my research, there were a couple of ideas that had industrial value, and we protected those by patent. And some of them also led to starter and spin-out companies. A few of them collapsed, but there are still three that are active. And because of that, I was also asked by the Delft University to represent them in all sorts of venture capital activities of the university. So what you hear that is that I slowly moved away from technical work more into finance, business, and so on. At a certain moment, I became the director of the Dutch biotech programs. That happened in 2004. And since then, I have built the Dutch biotech programs at the interface of industry, looking into starters and in the international arena. And that brought me a lot into interaction with Brazil and particularly collaborations with Unicamp that continue until today. I had a few excursions in the industry, but like for instance a year in Royal Dutch Shell. But I see myself really as an academic person, but you know, at the interface to industry, to society, and so on. In 2012, I was asked by our minister, then Minister of Economic Affairs, to lead the bioenergy policy for the Netherlands. That helped to project the Dutch strategy towards bioenergy at large scale. I was part of the founding board in that, and that is still in existence. I am not a board member anymore. I'm advised sometimes, but it was the foundation of the large scale policy making and so on. At a certain moment, I was asked by the group around KLM, Royal Dutch Airlines, to start helping with the solutions that they needed for greening aviation. And I became a chairperson of the Bioport Holland platform in 3-4 years. And that has led to preparing the market for aviation fuels investments. And maybe some of you have followed it. And I saw Pedro Scorza at the list of participants who I know from that time, Goal. And he probably should have seen that. There is now not only the announcement, but the actually building of an committed, dedicated biokerosene plant in the northern part of the Netherlands for sustainable aviation fuel, SAF. So that's a little bit of the Dutch storyline. Having done that for 15 years, it was time for a change, I thought. So I reduced time at Delft, although I'm still there, and am now in Ireland leading a new institute in structured materials, where we research structured materials for particularly grand challenges in health, environment, and also energy. And what we can do very well is characterization, you know, all the microscopy and the high-end TEM type of microscopy, the design of new materials, range of areas, batteries, aviation, aircraft, medical devices, and so on. And particularly, we also look into how to make them, manufacture them, and so on. So there's a little bit of my history in a nutshell, I would say. My technical, why doesn't it move? Yeah, it does move. My group in Delft is still continuing. They have different leaders. I'm there like on and off, one day in the weekends and so on. They have really changed gears on things, but the target is still the same. You know, you have an idea at the molecular level and you want to build a process that helps the planet and that goes to different stages in scaling up. And I've been active in most of these areas, from molecular to the process scale. And and this very messy diagram that I can send to you if you wish, sort of gives a snapshot of the research that was at high throughput experimentation, where we got the properties of molecules, thermodynamics. And if you move to the left bottom panel, we worked a lot on device design, bioreactor design. We worked on integrated processes. And if we go to the top right panel, how to see that in the larger perspective of an economy. And in the center, the collaborations that we have, and Unicamp is on that sheet as well. So, so much about myself. And now I would say to the topic, I think we are all motivated by progressing a bioeconomy in many ways, you know, and from the many disciplines that we are. So many people from different, very different disciplines in there. And Brazil is obviously an example where a very important step has been taken in terms of light vehicle fuels for cars, the whole ethanol scene with all its economic parameters around it. You know, still, if we look around the planet, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, we thought that bioeconomy would come. 2020 was a time that all of this should already be on the ground and large scale. The chemical industry should not have a few products. It should have been transformed about 30 years. So the question is, Why doesn't that take off? And of course, often is pointed to the fossil economy and the low cost and that sort of things. And so many of the activities that we have undertaken, also in collaboration with Unicamp, are to look into, would it be possible to have processes that are at the minimum competitive what the fossil industry has been able to develop over their 100-year time frame? Or do we need to have another track? You know, why is it so slow? And it must have also economic consequences. So can we make better processes, more intensified processes that, you know, we put more pressure on it, we have less capital on it, less energy is a thing. And would that be the way to go? And there are developments that I will highlight in a few cases. But I will also try to point that there are limitations to it, that there are a few inherent issues on this strategy, and that we must have a really good strategy in order to see what benefits and not. You know, bioethanol is a great thing, but the world is not only bioethanol. Bioethanol needs to be a stepping stone to other things as well. And an aircraft doesn't fly on bioethanol. It needs other stuff. So, there are a few inherent issues, and I really went back with a couple of the colleagues. You saw at my title slide that I worked with Solange Musato, who's nowadays in Denmark. She's still a Brazilian citizen from Lorena, but she's now in Denmark, and with a guy from Purec, nowadays the Corbion company, who have a manufacturing unit in the state of Rio de Janeiro. And with them, I looked into many of the cases that we have done and to see, you know, can we see some systematics in this and where should it be going. So we have a lot of case studies. I'm not going to discuss all of them, but I take from the one case study and I try to make that a very central point. From that, we can, if we do understand where the technical problem is, we can start expanding that and look into co-production of chemicals with the fuels, to complicate it further in terms of the logistic network for feedstocks and the products, the formation of markets for intermediate compounds like platforms. And my idea is over the coming, I'll say 5 or 10 years of my career, I'm still in the directorship, but you know, there are things that you also want to have a scientific line to it, on to get to something that looks like a checklist. You know, what can we do in order to get to better processes that that are implemented quicker, that, and that has to do a lot with the economy, and that has to do with emission profiles. Now, some of you may be familiar with process intensification. Process intensification, that is an range, a whole basket of approaches that is taken to make cheaper, more productive processes. And much of that is related to getting more driving force. And that's a central term that I will be exploiting in this lecture quite a bit. More driving force on a process. You know, if you want to push harder, then things should go better. That is the whole idea between process intensification. It can be done at several scales, very small scale, very large scale. And it leads to maximization of driving forces, so putting a lot of pressure. Of course, if you put pressure on a thing, that would cost energy and would cost the pump. So there is cost involved in that. And the question is that cost that you put into the system, that is energy, and energy in general is also related to the emissions that you create when you are starting to produce the energy in a form that you can use it, like steam or electricity, does that really also have the impact that you want, or is it wasted energy, you know, and what is the minimum amount of that, and can you really reduce, for instance, your capital cost on it, and is this whole process intensification approach where you focus on maximizing that that driving force, is that a good idea, or should you take a deeper look into that? Now, as a case study that I will come back to later, I have used our analysis of the Brazilian sugarcane processes. Well, I know that I'm with a lot of experts in the house, so I'm not going to explain this, but it is a report that we made in the year of 2005, which we developed in the Netherlands, used Dutch technology approaches to analyze these processes. And later on, we had a very intensive trip to Brazil, and we went to the details of these processes with people that you probably know as Jaime Fincheroot of the Piracicaba Center. And we made sure that what we had in hands was a reasonable reflection of the state of the art. At that time, 2005, we said, well, the second generation will come. It will take 10 years. Well, GranBio was there in 10 years, right? It's 2015. But it was our projection of from 2005 how 2015 would look like. And we verified that. If you are interested and you get the slides through Gonzalo, it is in the Delft repository, so you can all download it in with all the details that it had. This is like 300-400 pages on engineering computations and engineering stuff. So for me, this is a reflection of something that I know. And it is probably not the best, it's not the most updated case, but it's a case that we verified and that I trust. So the second generation was there. That was an idea that we had. But the second generation is not an intensified process. The second generation is taking technologies that are already around and is built, blocking them together, and gives a result. Intensified technology is, for instance, the biostill process, where people coupled the distillation directly to the fermentation process, removed the ethanol from it, reducing inhibition, and get to the ability of having more higher concentrated feedstocks. First glance, you know, this is the way to go. It looks like a much more intensive process, and still it didn't happen. Why this? Does this process that didn't happen? Why is the second generation slow in its uptake? And why do we see a lot of first generation processes around? And where is that going to develop to? You know, if you look in the back end, the bi-steel process, to me it is a case that does not work. At least it doesn't work so far. It has great difficulty, for instance, to cope with relatively low quality feedstock cost, because of the recycling you accumulate all the stuff in your fermenter. So everything that's bad sits still in your fermenter. The other thing is the operational stability needs to be good. Now, the Brazilian bioethanol processes are reasonably or even very stable processes. You can push and pull a lot. You know, the feedstock change across the season, processes still keep on performing. So it is a robust process. What you want is a biosteel process to do the same sort of thing. Now, of course, you analyze it with its capital cost, CapEx, and its operational cost. And I made a little table here that says, well, it minimizes water handling, for instance, if you combine the distillation. You can feed in a much more concentrated feedstock, 60% instead of 20% weight percent. That reduces the distillation volume by at least 50%, if not more. It gives relief to product inhibition, but there is an accumulation to anything else that you put in the process. So you work at a much higher osmotic pressure, meaning that the yeasts generally don't like it that much, but they start. So you have the danger of that they start producing glycerol. But bacteria don't like it even more. So it gives a very high resistance to bacterial infection. So there are all sorts of pluses and minuses in this. To me, there is it's not so clear what the outcome of this whole idea is, you know, because there are other mechanisms in place, in, for instance, Brazilian industry, to take care of the bacterial load in the ethanol fermentation by the acid wash. The decoupling of the distillation and fermentation gives another way of getting more operational stability to the full integrated system. And then there are all sorts of other questions, you know, why is this whole thing of steel? And in a way you are dealing with the population of producing yeast. How do you control this? And that topic is also one. So there was a 1993 workshop that we had on this topic when biosteel was the process that was going to conquer the world, and it didn't happen. So the way that you analyze this sort of processes, for those of you with an economic or a process economics background, this is all familiar. But if you look at the top of this diagram going down, if a company makes a decision, and thereby also if society start making decisions, there's a couple of things. It is dictated by two things. One is the techno-economic analysis, is it profitable or not? And the other are the things that I would call the jurisdiction. Is there a government that wants to stimulate? Is the capital market ready, interest rates? Are the regulations in place? Is the market there? Do you have people that can take the jobs? All these sort of things in jurisdiction. And some of that feeds into what is acceptable on the technical side. So the techno-economic analysis that is built on parameters that look into the finance around the system, so the return on investment, and all of it is there in its abbreviations. Payback times, net present value, internal rates of return, and all these sort of things. If you go down in that pyramid, of course, that relates to how much margin can you create in this process, and how does that relate to the amount of capital that you have to put in this process and to the operational cost of this process, the OPEX. OPEX and CAPEX are very important. They lead to the margin. The margin is the difference between the revenue of the products that you sell and the operational cost. And then you have a whole range of contributions to this operational cost. The feedstocks, the sugarcane, for this example, is one. All the auxiliary materials, and under that I also see things like power and heat and electricity and so on. Personnel are there. And then you have the capital cost with overheads, and they come back to equipment. So this is like the, so if you go from top to bottom or from bottom to top, this is the way that you do an economic analysis of a process, a standard way. But both have to be right. You know, the techno-economic analysis has to give positive numbers, and the things that I call in the jurisdiction, you know, there must also be an appetite for taking it up. And ethanol in Brazil was perfect storm. Now, where does this whole thing about process intensification come in? It should lead to lower capital costs, and it should lead to lower operational costs. And it all goes back to the driving forces. So if I put more energy in a process to drive it, would that also lead to an improvement in your auxiliary material ratio? Well, probably not, because you are using more of that. It should, for instance, lead to a smaller scale equipment, so lower investment cost that way. So the driving force, the control of driving force, is a very important parameter in the techno-economic design of these processes. So for ethanol processing, we come back to that example, you have to identify what are the real driving forces in the ethanol process. Part of that is the feedstock, but part of that is also the power and the energy that sometimes come from the feedstock or that he can take from somewhere else that drive the process. And if you take more of it, you can reduce scale. If you mix harder in a fermenter, you can reduce the scale. If you have a higher reflux ratio in distillation column, you can reduce the scale. But there's a penalty, and the question is there a limit to that? So the way that that Solange, Jan and I looked at it is, you know, and this is not the only case that we were looking at, are there inherent problems in this approach? You know, all the details are fine. We put more pressure on one thing, so the equipment gets smaller, put more energy in it, but it doesn't work out in the total. It is a little bit like this this sketch of Escher, you know. All the details are correct, but it is impossible to operate this process. And if you take an analysis of the water mill that is fed by the water, you know, it is continuously performing work, but it is not clear where that work comes from. There are no emissions. Well, we all know that processes have emissions and so on. And it is very unclear where the driving force comes from. And driving force, and I will try to bridge that to thermodynamics. I know that for some of you, this is not a favorable topic, but I will bridge it to thermodynamics. And the driving force for processes should be a change in the Gibbs energy of a compound. And you know that spontaneous processes have negative delta G. And that goes back to your thermodynamics classes for some of us. That is a long time ago. But that lacks, you know, we have a thing that is just operating and there is nothing coming in and out. So that can't be. And we know that it can't be, but why? So I'm like halfway, I think, in the lecture now. So we are getting to the topic of work analysis of real processes. That helps. And work analysis, I really mean in terms of thermodynamic work. We need to know what's the minimum amount of it in terms of work, which is heat to a process, steam, pressure, auxiliary materials, power, and so on to drive a process. We are interested in what is the fate of that work after the process. Can you still do something with it, or is it just waste and goes away? And something about the structure of the process. So sometimes these processes are really complicated, and it is not so easy to identify what is the real driving force for such a process. So now bear with me for the few slides next to it, because I will go a little bit back deeper in the thermodynamics, but we need it in order to get a more fundamental answer of why some of the processes just don't work and never will be competitive with others. So processes that we analyze are all open systems. So in open systems, you convert the feedstock into products, sugar into ethanol for that matter, but you need a high quality type of energy like electricity, and you convert it in a low quality type of energy like, for instance, wastewater and so on. There is a minimum amount of work that you need to do, the W min, and that is dictated by the Gibbs energy that is stored in the final products relative to the Gibbs energy that is in the feedstock. That is the minimum that you should exert on a process, otherwise it doesn't work. That is what basic thermodynamics tell you. In reality, you need much more than that. And one of them is you need to drive the process, you know, and there are losses. If you put you put energy through a process, you lose part of it, and that is, yeah, is useless. That is useless. So we have a minimum, and we know that we need something else to keep an alive process, and we know that we are going to lose part of that. Now let me try to illustrate that with two examples. If we have a distillation column, we have to put in high temperature steam at the bottom, and we recover low temperature water at condensate at the top. So the driving force is essentially related to the heat that we put in the bottom of the system and that we recover from the top of the system. The amount is the same, but the quality is different because of the temperature profile. In biology, you have this sort of systems also. All living systems need a substrate and a product, but they need a minimum amount, otherwise they die and they are not producing. And we want them to not die, but we want them to produce also. And well, you can bring it to yourself, you know, if you don't eat, you die. But you you can eat somewhat, but then you won't grow. But there is a limit to that. Over that limit, you start growing, you produce more of yourself, and that is desired because we get all heavier and so on. So the question that we now try to answer with this background in why some of the processes have this energy use and so on, we bring to the topic of bioprocess intensification. We want to have higher driving forces that should lead to higher rates of elements of these processes. And that should make them smaller. Smaller equipment, lower cost, that's the idea. But we have a higher energy price to pay. If we go back to thermodynamics again, and the way that we design processes, that is usually with mass balances and equilibria, that is related to chemical potentials and so on. At that time, we can already start doing the basic economics of a process. That's called the economic potential, because that is good enough, mass balance and phase equilibria, to determine the main process flows, the main material flows, the main energy flows. And there we can start doing the first calculation whether the process has a certain economy at all. We don't know yet scale of equipment. We don't know the capital cost. That's the next step. If you go further on in designing equipment, you need an idea about transport rates, and you need an idea about how much work you put in the process. And the transport rates are related to differences in energy. Think of a slide, think of from high potential energy to low potential energy. You can have a flux is by the indication of N, so you push more to the equipment, higher pressure difference, higher flux to it, that's right. But the trick is in the following thing, that is that the work that is necessary, that is to do that, is related to the size of that flow, so N, but also to the driving force. And there comes the trick, the driving force is now squared in the losses of the work. So if you're still with me, otherwise, you know, just remember that the gradient in the Gibbs energy is the driving force. That will have higher fluxes, so lead to smaller equipment, so lead to smaller capital cost. And so the driving force is proportional to one over, sorry, the capital costs are proportional to one over the driving force. And the loss work is proportional to the driving force squared. So if you put up your driving force, the amount of steam that you need to get something done more pays extra proportionally more. It is quadratic, whereas your capital goes only down linearly. But there is a problem. That is one of the inherent problems of process optimization. Let's not forget it. So I try to sort of sketch that in the diagram below, but this is exactly the same discussion that we have. So in the bottom diagram on the horizontal axis, only look at that one, it says driving force. That could be expressed in many ways, this Gibbs energy or whatever you want to use there. Often there is a minimum amount. That is what I understood. That try to explain with these things like maintenance. What's the minimum amount of sandwiches that you have to eat in order to not die? And on the vertical axis, I put the value of the capital cost, the operational cost, and particularly the auxiliary materials component in it. And so the capital cost in generally go down with driving force. That is what I just said in mathematical terms. The operational costs go up, but not linearly, but quadratically. Yeah, and the total cost sits somewhere in the middle. So the question is really, what's the balance between capital, operational cost? Where would things be going? There's not always an easy discussion, because the desolation column that that we had on the previous slide, the modern desolation columns, for instance, for ethylene separations, are not driven in the way of an reboiler in the bottom with a high energy input and a condenser top with a low quality energy out, but they are driven by, for instance, something like a vapor recompression cycle. So there's actually, you take the vapor off the top, you compress it, it gets a higher temperature, you put it back into the system. That gives a smaller device, it gives it reduces the energy cost. But yeah, what's the driving force? The driving force is now not related to the heat that you put in and the condenser heat that you take out, but it is related to the electrical power of the compressor that is in the cycle. So, and modern processes have all these sort of tricks and tools that make it difficult to analyze them. Okay, so back to the diagram that I already had about decision making for bio-based economy, and that could be at company level, but it could also be at societal level. The choices that we make around process structure and driving force have impacts everywhere. So the red impact is the negative ones, and the green impact is the positive ones. So higher driving force, negative is more power, more steam, more emissions, more of that sort that feeds negatively in the operational expenditures. But higher driving force means smaller equipment scale, smaller capital cost, and smaller contributions to the overall capital. And in your key performance indicators, like for instance return on investment, you have a lower capital number that that comes in. So that's where the balance is. The reds and the greens should be balanced. And what we also saw in the previous really fundamental analysis is that the capital goes down linearly, but that the operational cost expenditures, the amount of power, goes up quadratically. So the harder we push, the harder we have to pay for it, and the payment is really dear. So that process intensification is something that is a dangerous area to be in. Now the next, I'm looking a little bit at time, I skip over the next few slides, but Solange and Jan and myself used the pandemic closure to write down a paper in which we had the mathematics right around this topic and did the analysis. So don't try to look at to analyze the sheet, but the paper basically tells you that there's a very fundamental reason why some processes really don't work, and they will never be able to do so. We did do that analysis for a number of cases. So we had a theoretical process that we looked into, and we had a simple thing like membrane-based concentration to just demonstrate how that methodology worked. And then we went to the processes that I will focus on now. So how did that work out if you start comparing your classical bioethanol case versus the biosteel process to the second generation? But if you're interested in how the methodology works, I took some graphs from that publication. We are in the late stages of the review process, so I assume that it will be out in a few months. If the reviewers don't understand it, we have to go to a different journal, as always. But if you are interested, send me an email, and I will send you the manuscript because I think it has value, this paper. Part of the outcome is, of course, how does the contribution of the auxiliary materials, the operational cost versus the capital in the operational cost, how do they match? Because if the one is very much smaller than the other one, you know, they, yeah, you only see the dominant one. And you would expect that that is fairly different if you go from monoclonal antibodies to insulin, so very high-end pharmaceutical compounds with a process that looks like a fermentation process for ethanol, by the way. For citric acid, which is sort of intermediate scale food ingredient, and to ethanol. And these cases are also documented. If you're interested, the paper gives the references, of course. I'll be happy to send them separately to you. But one is, the first three have been analyzed by Dimitri Petridis of Intelligen. They're documented, and there's one by Tsari Avin, my student, who did do this ethanol case development. So the lines that you need to compare, I don't know whether my cursor is visible, but is there is a capital related contribution to the operational cost. That is the third line in the table, and there is an auxiliaries, aux related component to that. So for monoclonal antibodies, it is 46% over 22%. So the one is double the other one. For insulin, it is the other way down. But if you go for larger scale processes, like for citric acid and ethanol, you see that these things become in the same value. So we are really always balancing the operational costs. And if you start pushing more, you get higher operational costs, and my prediction, quadratically higher. And we don't see the benefit of at the capital side. So we really have to move for processes that take in larger scale investments. That is a very unwelcome message to the investors, but they will pay, they get their payment back, because energy will be more expensive in the future. And maybe the energy won't be expensive, but the emissions will be expensive. So you need to shift from capital, giving priority to capital expenditure to really operational cost expenditure in total. Now, let's move to the ethanol case that shows that already. So the ethanol case is around a 5 million ton sugarcane processing plant. So the 5,000 kilotons per year is the same for all these processes. The columns indicate 2005, that is the conventional first generation ethanol process, I would say. The biostill version we discussed is the column next to it. And the 2015 process, that is this hypothetical lignocellulosic process. So the base case produces roughly 166 kilotons of ethanol with 350 kilotons of sugar to it, and it has a significant excess of power that goes to the grid that should relate to about 35 megawatts. The typical plants may be a bit smaller or larger than this, but that gives a representation of the outcomes. Now, if you put in this biostill process, the amount of ethanol that you're converting is of course the same, because the amount of sugar is the same. That you put in this process, assuming that sugar still goes into a sugar and ethanol stream, but you need significantly more power in the process itself because of the increased circulations. That means that the power sales go down, and you see the impact on revenue, on operational cost, on margin, and instead of what you would expect, that you get a really cheaper process and thus a larger return on investment, ROI is for return on investment, you see that the biostill processes give you a more complicated process with a lower return on investment. So it is an inherent problem that we are facing. It doesn't do what it is designed to do. If you take a look at the second generation process, where we have the same intake, but we look differently in what to do with all the outcomes. So we don't put so much of the bagasse into electricity, but we use that. As a matter of fact, we even buy electricity to convert bagasse into the composing sugars. Then You know, the margins are entirely different. Of course, also the capital expenditure will be different, will be way higher in this case, but the productivity will also be different. Now, all of these are numbers of 2005 that we did this study. It probably looks slightly different now, and it depends really on a number of factors, but it gives you the idea that further utilization of your feedstock and giving it having higher yields is a way more better strategy than a strategy to try to reduce your capital expenditures. And that is a lesson that comes not only from this one. There are many, many examples of this this sort. So really important is what you do with your biorefinery structure, what sort of co-products you make. That the investment may be higher is an issue. Sure, you have to deal with that. But on the longer run, and with the economy as it is developing, with more pricing to emissions and so on, our prediction is that that is a better strategy for getting a bioeconomy on the ground. So I'm looking a little bit at time if you want to have some discussion, but the ways to further explore that is what sort of co-products would you then prefer to make? For instance, if we take this structure of a biorefinery as a model, you have some harvest with logistics that goes into pretreatment hydrolysis. There you have a need to get power, convert part of that into power. And then you have a range of products that you can make from it. That could be food and feed ingredients. Ethanol, fuel is one. Chemical products is an alternative. And it could, and of course you can sell it to the grid. My take on it, long run, don't do that, but convert it into the chemical products and liquid energy carriers as a strategy. If you want to do that same techno-economic analysis for multi-product systems, we took another case that we did do in the port of Rotterdam and looked into the conversion of imported wood chips into the sugars via a biorefinery process and in the production of lignin. And on the axis here, you see the market prices for sugar and for lignin. And of course, if both are high, you would invest, and if both are low, you would not invest. So in the blue area, you can start investing. Now, the lines that I plotted are the lines that represent the net present value. So it is basically an indicator whether you should invest in the bank or not. And if the net present value is zero, it doesn't really matter. You can invest or not. It is not a big plus. But if it is negative, you better not invest in this. So if you are at that line, most of the processes that we know of now, and that is the classical mill in Brazil, they burn their residue stream. They burn the bagasse to produce electricity. That means that that in order to be feasible, your sugar price has to be reasonably high. But if you can find another outlet for lignin that gives you a higher value, then the total could lead to lower ethanol costs, for instance, and have an operatable process and an investment that you can do. So we did do a couple of those examples. You're now a bit familiar with this triangular diagram. So the vertical axis is still sugar prices. The diagonal lines are the net present value. There's a zero line, so you should be above the diagonal in order to have an investable situation. And at the bottom, the horizontal axis, we have a number of products, not only energy, but also like bitumen, asphalt. You know, if you go to a bio-based economy, there is no asphalt from oil anymore. So it needs to come from somewhere. And the price of those is in the order of 200, and I think in this case, euros per ton. That brings the ethanol price down by 30%. If you would make polyols, for instance, for polyurethanes, then it goes up to 400 euros per ton, and your equivalent ethanol price could go down to 150. And if you make marine bunker oil to green shipping, and that material costs also around 400 to 500 euros per ton. You know, so even making lignin into some kind of pyrolysis process to marine bunker fuel is a good strategy to do. And of course, whether that's good for your situation is not, but from port, there's definitely a good strategy. So this diversification policy is a way better strategy than trying to reduce only on the equipment side of the cost. Now, what sort of products would you better make? So we made have this diagram. I think some of you may recognize it, used it before, but it shows sort of elemental composition of commodity products in terms of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. The less oxygen, the higher the energy content. The more hydrogen, the higher the energy content. Of course, fossil is all on the bottom axis of this triangle because the feedstock is of that composition. That's good because it gives you very high energy dense materials, which is good for fuels. But an unfortunate result of that is that also the materials that you make, like polyethylene and polypropylene, PE and PP and polystyrene and so on, have the same high density. So if you want to use them, for instance, in constructions, they are flammable, which is undesired. So there is that's an undesired consequence, but we live with it because of the feedstocks. For a bio-based world with more oxygen in the feedstocks and still a need for producing these fuels for some sectors, like for instance for aviation and to some extent maybe also for marine sector, you have to do something with the rest of the oxygen. So if part of the feedstock sugars or derivative products of the sugars go into, for instance, natural gas, into liquid fuels, then you must find more oxygen-rich products. And that's exactly the strategy that you now see with some of the chemical companies to divert to polyesters, to polyethers, and so on. Because in a way, what you do is make sure that the redox balance of your total process is good. Again, basic thermodynamics that will tell you that. Now, I skip the following slides because it is more of the same. So I hope that you're still with me. Thermodynamics is not our favorite topic in general, but I tried to illustrate here that is, if you want to work on cases that work, overall yields are key. The utilization of feedstock and energy is key. But I just mentioned the overall redox balance. If you look into a feedstock that is partially oxidized like biomass and you have fully reduced products, you must think of oxidized products also. Otherwise, it leads to significant losses. The next step is have your thermodynamics in place, you know, and particularly the driving force. I hope that I convinced you. The techno-economic analysis is key. Antonio Bonomi and the virtual biorefinery to guide where we are going. I think it is really important to have that work going on. The process structure, I didn't go into the details there, but there are process structures that are inherently more costly than others. You need to look at that. And what we are going to focus on, basically extending a lot of work that we also did do with colleagues in Brazil, is to look more into the multi-product aspects. What will happen if you pre-process material, you have a platform that you want to develop a bigger market for? How does all of that, those logistics look like? We have a range of new projects in the sustainable aviation fuel space, particularly flanking the new biokerosene plant that is set up by Sky Energy, that should be operational in 2022, 100,000 tons per year of sustainable aviation fuel. But we are already working on the 1.1 version of it. What sort of co-products do we need to make? And we are using the analysis tools that I showed with you. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you very much for your interest. Happy to send the slides to Gonzalo for further distribution, and happy to take any further discussion on this. So, muito obrigado.
Look, thank you very much. Great presentation. Sorry for the delay. You are still handling to understand the functionality of the Zoom. So it's a pity that you cannot applause. But it's very important what you say, to what you show in terms of this technical economical analysis. Really, a lot of questions that raised from your. Just a second, I will ask people if they want to make questions. Please, tem uma posição aí, pessoal, para colocar uma mãozinha para cima. Dê uma olhadinha. Quem quiser fazer perguntas, por favor, coloque aí. Eu vou tirar o mudo aí de todo mundo. Por favor, recoloquem se não forem falar, mas vamos lá. Look, I have one question for you, and it's very important your outcome to say that we need to have other products from our biorefineries.
Yeah.
And oxygen is advantage in several situations, as you have shown. For example, now in this pandemic, we have seen a study from Harvard shown that the people that is living in areas where you have this heavy transportation because of the particulates, the correlation between mortality and density of transportation was clear, was direct. That means when we have, for example, in São Paulo, ethanol in the cars, the advantage that we had in the atmosphere was clear, was enormous. And this means directly a health advantage. My question for you, in Brazil, you know, the RenovaBio is producing now a new product that I believe a lot. This is a financial product, mm-hmm. yeah? That's a very important product from biorefineries. Mm-hmm. And in order for products like this really to gain value, to be important worldwide, this will depend a lot on the perception of biofuels. What's your opinion about biorefineries in Europe and the biofuels as a possible future fuel for Europe, considering the possibility of the development of the fuel cells?
Good point. Really a good point. I think the two places should not be compared. The Brazilian economic system and transport system is different, and population distribution is different from Europe. And Europe has also diversity. The places where I live, the northwestern part, is really populated. And that doesn't have a lot of land mass. There are other places, Germany towards the east, Russia, and to the south in France and Portugal. There are large areas that are really very suitable for bioenergy production, and that potential has been estimated. So and that is significant. Now, what do you want to organize? Now, for a country like the Netherlands, electrical vehicles are a good solution. But if you go outside, if you want to drive with your car to southern France, you know, that's a thing. So I believe that the solution to the total energy matrix depends upon where you are. For Brazil, it is very clear. Ethanol can play a very good role. The question is now, how does ethanol move beyond being a fuel for light vehicles only? You know, conversion to diesel can be done. Conversion to aviation biofuels can be done. I think that is a strategy that must be taken from all the possibilities that we analyze for aviation fuels. For instance, the ethanol to jet routes is still very, very competitive in it. The result of that is that you have still your oxygen-rich feedstock for which you make well, ethanol that has some oxygen in it, but even more reduced compounds like diesel and kerosene. So you need to produce something else in addition to that if you want to have the maximum impact in your coins, your financial unit, that basically says something about the sustainability of the products that you make, right? The what's the name again? The BioCoin. I've got the name. Your unit.
Bitcoin. Bitcoin.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. That coin, the BioCoin. Let's call it BioCoin for the moment, okay? You know where I'm talking about. But if you take a political decision now and says, well, okay, so we all go for bioeconomy and we take the ethanol, we dehydrate it and make ethylene from it and then produce polyethylene from that ethanol, well, that looks good. You can do it technically. You know, Braskem has a plan to do it, so it can be done, no problem. But how much of these, how much sustainability do you add? Because you make, again, a more reduced compound and you still don't do anything with the oxygen. So a route that, for instance, considers polyesters as chemical products, and one of them is really interesting, that is called ethyl carbonate, which you can polymerize also. So it is ethyl carbonate, so a lot of carbon in that compound. A lot of oxygen in that compound. And what you would expect is that, for instance, if many uses of polyethylene are for packaging materials for which you want to have an oxygen barrier, you don't want oxygen to penetrate in your food product, for instance, for it. And if you have packaging material made from polyethyl carbonate, you say, well, this is high in oxygen, but oxygen in the polymer works as a barrier to oxygen permeating that polymer in the food, you know? So the choice for polyethyl carbonate is one that saves the planet better. It is a material at this moment, it is slightly more expensive than polyethylene, because polyethylene volumes are larger than that. But from a sustainability point of view, this is the way to go. And it can produce the same quality packaging materials as the classical polyethylene. So the whole structure around it means that if you move to bioeconomy, you should not stick to fossil product. Polyethylene is a fossil product. Now, how would you go about that with the market? So I think the market that becomes more ethanol driven and carbon driven, because I was talking about polyethyl carbonate, you know, we produce in the fermentation, we produce ethanol and carbonate, well, CO2, carbonate. So if you start combining that into a polymer, we have a much better situation. We have higher yields in final product. We have a product that is compatible with polyethylene type applications. So it is, so the choices that you make are really dictated by the structures that you look in, the market structures that you look in. So an ethanol economy all around would be a good thing. So think beyond ethanol in the application of the light vehicle. Kerosene requires further dehydration and polymerization, but all the chemical products can come from that route. And if for particular applications you need another heat profile or you need another elasticity modulus and so on that you can't get with polyethylene, there is a whole range that polylactic acid is another one. It's not been exploited fully for all the uses that it can have. Now, polylactic acid cups were, when the materials development wasn't so far, were not usable for warm coffee. You know, the cup would implode, but that has been over. You know, we can do that. We can do that now. That materials development. That's why I'm in the materials structured materials research institute. You know, that to make sure that we understand how things. And let me give you another solution to this. Power is important for our societies. Electricity is important for our societies. So how do you want to make power? Well, wind energy gives a very low cost power, probably at this moment the lowest cost of electricity is renewable. That's good. But what do you do with all the wind turbines after use? At this moment, they are made of fossil polymer with glass fibers in it. You know, they are intimately connected, and it is impossible to reuse all that that stuff. So part of the developments that we have is lignin, not as a low value combusted product, or not even converted into what I suggested, the bunker fuel, but made into carbon fibers at the quality that you can have in wind turbines. That's a renewable product in wind turbines. And we are now working with a couple of resin manufacturers on bio-based resins that can glue these fibers together into a blade that has the same properties as the conventional blade, but it is all renewable material. We have a second project where we look into how do we decouple that again, and they have made great advantages on that. And the third topic, but that is work in the going, we can now also produce this sort of turbine blades, not only in a section of 2 or 3 meters that then needs to be bolted on another section of 2 or 3 meters to get you a realistic blade. But we can make that now in one go with a sort of 3D, 2 composite sprinting technology, can make that all in one go. So materials development is in those cases important. So that is a link that we are now discussing with the Irish electricity company, with the Irish forestry company, whether this would be renewable electricity with also the turbines made renewable as a possible future for them. So I didn't answer your question about ethanol in Europe, but I give you another answer about that.
Look, you know, I have a lot. I totally agree with you. We must go in this direction of material. I do believe that ethanol is much more than fuel. It's much more than biofuel. This is a perfect building block for a lot of things. It's not ready to go. We need transformations, modifications. But this is an advantage because then we are going to have a lot of innovation, a lot of research to put in. Lignin is the same. I totally agree with you. We need another way to think in molecules with oxygen. I have here a number of questions. I put 2 questions together here. One from Gustavo Valença, question asking about the percentage of bagasse you'd need to bring to profit margins of ethanol to double. Easy question. And the other one is what do you think about the biogas as a complement of ethanol in a biorefinery? This is a Brazilian situation.
Yeah.
And the LCA analysis to evaluate the GHG to improve biofuel valuation. This is Ricardo Simões, Ricardo Abreu. That means.
Let me start with Gustavo's question on the percentage of bagasse to go into as high as possible profit margin. All of it. Why electricity? Don't convert bagasse into electricity. At the moment, electricity in Brazil is as cheap as it is at this moment, and most of it renewable also. So anything that that prevents you from burning bagasse in the boiler into electricity is a good strategy, in my view. Depends, of course, on the prices of the moment. You know, that's. But electricity prices globally only go down. There are no countries with increasing electricity prices on the longer run, maybe periodically, but it is certainly they go down. So the one that I showed you, that study indicates it. I've seen others that gave roughly the same conclusion. As much as possible, bagasse into products that are liquid fuels, that is the best for the margin.
The other is your idea about biogas production in biorefinery. How do you see this? And the LSA analysis, I do believe that LSA changes everything. As you said, as you have said, wind production. What's the LCA of the turbine? No one shows this clearly. Please, your comments, Luke.
Yeah, because residues to biogas are the technology is relatively simple. There is, of course, a substantial amount of residues that could go in biogas that way. But you, I think, in terms of gas transportation, local use of gas is usually better than transporting gas. You need to, otherwise to compress it. Now, one solution to it, and that is coming at the market, is that diesel engines, the diesel cycle, can be re-engineered to have gas injection in it. That's a bit of a technical topic, but it is good to look again into the diesel cycle. And if you start injecting gas, so for about 30%, 30-40% is the maximum gas that you can inject in that diesel cycle. So you run your engine normally with diesel, but you replace at part of the cycle. You inject the biogas in it, then you get the full power. And what it also does do, it improves the combustion characteristics of the diesel. So diesel is little droplets, and the flue gas that you see, the black smoke out of the diesel engines in the trucks, you know, we all see that, is essentially unconverted diesel droplets. Who have become like a carbon black type of components, unconverted. The moment you inject gas into it, that goes away. The soot is reduced by 99% or more. So that's not only a solution then for the usinas and the heavy truck transportation around the usinas, but it is also a solution into the cities. And you don't need to completely convert your engine can stay the same, but there is a little manipulation necessary on the injection cycle. And there was a spin out in the Netherlands that has done it, competing with Volvo, who is doing something comparable at this moment, sort of dual fuel system. And the interesting thing is it brings the soot down a lot, but it also gives the power response of the engine. The original development came from people that were looking into diesel for racing into race cars, and then saw that gas injection gave the engine a better response curve. I'm not a combustion guy, so I don't know the details here, but that's where it came from. And it works for diesel engines, large scale, really very well. And I've seen tests with the diesel engine for trucks that worked, but the diesel engines, for instance, for dredging for ships, you know, these are these engines with cylinders that are this size, you know, 50 liter engines or 100 liter engines, which are very incomplete in their combustion. That's why these ships have all these black smoke and so on. If you start using this technology in it, all the smoke is gone. The profiles go down, and there is even some evidence, because you bring a little bit down the combustion temperature, that also the NOx formation goes down. So it seems to work in all the directions. So biogas for local use.
Look, perfect. What you said, we have some companies in Brazil making this modification in the diesel motor in order to have actually, they think in methanol. Natural gas is normally the option. However, with the RenovaBio and the possibility to have a carbon coin, for example, you can put natural gas, however, buying and put into retire some carbon coins like these C-Bios.
Yeah.
You could in a financial operation to convert this natural gas in biogas.
Yeah, absolutely. And then again, it is as an ingredient for diesel. You know, if you give more value to the biogas than if you use it as a diesel replacer, than if you use it as an station as a gas in a stationary engine.
This is the way. Perfect. What you say is perfect, because a lot of people is thinking this only about save money, reduce. But no, what you put now about this advantage of diesel combustion in terms of the consequence in health and even in the financial consequence in public health is wonderful.
Yeah. I see also another question, if I may interrupt you, yes, Gonzalo, please. From Henrique about to access the impact of reliability factors that influence the downtime of processes. When you compare different approaches, such as continuous saccharification and continuous or semi-continuous pretreatment and hydrolysis for second generation production. Well, that's a very good point. The whole reliability of pretreatment has been a big topic. The first developments by, for instance, the Dini on their rapid hydrolysis process was suffering from a lot of problems, you know, and the problem is very, very simple. If you bring solid materials under high pressure and high temperature into an high friction system like what you're doing, you know, that's a recipe for disaster. And the reason why it is done is to get a sort of continuous feed into the pretreatment system. Take the hydrolysis, the pretreatment unit, and split it, maybe make it a little bit larger, and operate these two vessels and alternate the operation of the two vessels. You know, you can fill the one if the other is in operation. So the filling doesn't require a high temperature, high pressure scroll, which is the real problem in the continuity of that operation. So yes, you spend a little bit more on capital, but the operational stability is significantly larger. So that is one of my feedbacks to this. There is of course much more to say, because the second generation relies on a number of processes, but we have solved a lot of problems. You know, the fact that xylose can be converted next to glucose was a step that nobody held for possible, and it is common now that components some of the co-products like acetic acids that are co-produced can also be converted into ethanol in the same system. You know, this is a further development of the technologies. You can't expect that if we have one Grand Bio plant and one DuPont plant and one DSM plant, that we have a mature technology. You know, the refineries needed to be built by the dozens in order to get stable operation. So for feedstocks in this, it is the same thing. And I think what the discussions about, for instance, the harvesting of sugarcane and how to make sure that you get sugarcane to the plants that is of which sufficiently the soil is removed, that you don't have the soil buildup in the plant and all the abrasion problem. That means that you have to look into harvesting technology. Well, you know much better than I knew all these stories with the energy cane and that required complete redevelopment of the of it in order to get a stable functioning system. And the downtime, for instance, of the DSM Poet plant in Emmitsburg was related to solids built up, sand built up in the plant. You know, it came with the feedstock because the harvesting was not tuned to what it needed. So My general question is, I'm a great believer in technology development, so I believe that we can get the reliability of these processes up, but you know, we have to treat that with professional engineering and look for what the real problem is.
Yeah. Look, fantastic talk. Good that we now, with this pandemic, we began to put everything in YouTube. That means we can see again. It's not a talk that we can only in 1 hour understand and take the details. I'd like very much to send you a message to have a private talk next week with you to put together some plans and to see the future. Look, thank you very much. Thank you very much for everybody that is here with us. And have a good week. Thank you, Luke. See you soon.
Ciao, bye-bye.
Ciao, muito obrigado.